الحمد لله الذي هدانا للإيمان وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله بعث بالدين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى tells us in سورة الأنبياء، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، إن هذه أمتكم أمة واحدة وأنا ربكم فاعبدون. To reflect on the meaning of this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. This nation is one nation. وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُوهُ. And I am your God, I am your Lord, worship me. Subhanallah. أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. One nation. What is this nation? What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referring to here? Is referring to the nation of believers. All the believers throughout time is one nation. Allah. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. The believers are brothers. Allah. So this nation of believers is one nation, and Allah is our God, so we worship Him. And inshallah today we'll go through part of Surah Al-Anbiya to see some of the lessons and to learn some of the lessons of this surah. Because the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, as humans, we go through trials. And the most that go through trials are the prophets. They have the highest level of trials, hardships. And as we learn from what the prophets went through to see how they dealt with situations, we will see that our situation, regardless how tough times we go through, ours is much easier. But also, we will learn from their behavior and learn how to act in certain circumstances. And we'll see that our issues or problems or whatever has been mentioned in the Quran and lived by others, and we'll see how they dealt with it and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the prayers and get us out of these problems. So as we read the Quran, we have to reflect on how does it affect us? What do we learn? And how does it improve our lives? Because that's what the Quran is. Huda, rahmah, guidance, mercy, nur. It's light. It brings us out and finds a solution to our problems. So inshallah, first Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the prophets, Allah mentions, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى وَهَارُونَ الْفُرْقَانَ وَضِيَاءً وَذِكْرًا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning Musa and Harun, and both together. Because as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in another ayah, اذهبا إلى فرعون إنه طغى. Go to Fir'aun. He's a tyrant. Subhanallah. So here Musa and Harun are going to go to this great king, to this great Pharaoh, as he is a tyrant. But how do you deal with it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, فقولوا له قولا لينا لعله يتذكر أو يخشى. Talk to him nicely. He's a tyrant. He said to his people, أَنَا رَبُّكُمْ الْأَعْلَىٰ, I am your greatest God. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs Musa and Harun, the prophets and the messengers, to go and talk to him nicely, layyina, and in a kind way. Maybe he will remember and maybe he will fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if we look, they are humans. Musa and Harun are humans. Prophets and messengers are humans just like all of us. Ya Allah, how could we go to this tyrant? He might kill us, he might revenge from us. So what does they say? قَالَ رَبُّنَا إِنَّا نَخَافْ أَنْ يُفْرَطْ عَلَيْنَا أَوْ أَنْ يَطْغَى. So they are humans. And Allah sent them to talk to a tyrant. So they say, Ya Allah, we are afraid that he might punish us or he might be a tyrant to us. And Allah, it's a normal human reaction and human feelings that when we talk to tyrants or talk to people of power, there is that fear. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? قَالَ لَا تَخَافَ إِنَّنِي مَعْكُمْ أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَى. Don't worry. Don't be afraid. I am with you. I see and I hear. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wisdom, they shouldn't be afraid because He will protect them. And this is a lesson for all of us as we are going in a tough situation and dealing with a tough person. Don't worry and don't be afraid. Allah is with us. So we be prepared and know that Allah is with us and we should not be afraid. That is the message. But most of us say, no, I won't deal with it. I won't touch it because he's a tyrant. He's bad. It's not my business. And we all avoid it. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, no, don't be afraid. Tawakkal Allah. And Allah is with us. Inni ma'akuma asma' wa ara. I see and I hear. But that's the first lesson, inshallah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Prophet Ibrahim. وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ رُجْدَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَكُنَّ بِهَا عَلِمِينَ. And it's Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Again, we have guided him before. Again, it's the same issue. What happened? Ibrahim found that his people worship somebody other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذْ قَالَ لِأَبِيهِ وَقَوْمِ مَا هَذِهِ التَّمَاثِيلَ الَّتِي أَنْتُمْ لَهَا عَاكِفُونَ. He noticed they worship idols. It's just statues, subhanAllah. What is the statues, he asked. He doesn't say, I mind my own business. And he knows their tyrants and he knows they're powerful. And what is their answer? قَالُوا وَجَدْنَا أَبَاءَنَا لَهَا عَابِدِينَ. We have found their parents worshipping it, subhanAllah. Alhamdulillah ala ni'mat al-Iman, for we are Muslims and we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there is a lot of things that we attach to Islam. And when we ask a Muslim, why you do this? He says, my parents used to do it. Mostly it's culture issues, has nothing to do with Islam. وَجَدْنَا, just like they say, we've seen our parents worshipping the idols, so we worship them. We see a lot of things that attached and related, we think they're related to Islam. And when we ask why, we see our parents doing it. We see somebody else doing it, rather than question and say, is this really part of Islam? Because a lot of these things does not make sense. And they're not fitra. Islam is fitra. It's nature. Something inside us guides us to the straight path. SubhanAllah. Even a bad person knows what he's doing is wrong. When you ask him and discuss it, he will know. Even though he might argue, but he knows that this is wrong. Because there is something called fitra, especially in the Muslims, by nature. And that's why Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam told us, ask your heart. And if you feel it's wrong, you know it's wrong. And that's why we ask our hearts and we know it's wrong, so we try to find a sheikh to give us a fatwa that goes with our hawa. And we ask 3, 4 and we don't like, so we go to the 5th and 6th till we hear the one we like and say, I got the fatwa, subhanAllah, because we asked our heart. And our heart told us something is wrong, and yet we want to go. إِنَّ وَجَدْنَا وَجَدْنَا أَبَاءَنَا لَهَا عَابِدِينَ. We found our parents do the same thing. A lot of things attached, we found our parents. And as I mentioned before, when my daughter was young, I didn't eat ketchup. It wasn't in our culture to eat ketchup. Because most people who's grown up in the old days, there was no ketchup. But my daughter was born and grew up in Canada. She noticed she likes ketchup, but her dad doesn't eat ketchup. So when somebody asked her, why doesn't your dad eat ketchup? Her answer was, my dad is a Muslim. Muslims don't eat ketchup. That's her answer, because kids are perceptive, right? And the only thing is, my dad is a Muslim. That's probably why he doesn't eat ketchup. We relate things to our parents rather than think why. There is a lot of issues are cultures, and we're not saying they're right or wrong. They might be right, but still, it's not Islam. It's a culture issue, and we keep it as a culture issue because we don't relate it. Not because our parents did it. We ask, is it haram or halal? And then just like in the case of the ketchup, there's nothing wrong. So, but our parents, إِنَّ وَجَدْنَا أَبَاءَنَا لَهُ عَابِدِينَ. Our parents worshipped it. We follow the parents. We have to go and ask ourselves and rectify ourselves. So what does Ibrahim alayhi salam do? He waits till they all go out and he destroys most of the idols except one. SubhanAllah. And that's why the scholar tells us, if he wanted them not to worship the idols, he could have broken them all. But the issue is not to break the idols because they built new idols. He wanted to start the dialogue with them. Because when he left the big one, they came and said, who did this? And he told them, it wasn't me, it was their big one. Sees a shovel in his hand. They call it the smoking gun, is in the hand of the big idol. He must have done it. And ask him. So here the idea was not to break it. The idea is to start a dialogue between them and bring it to their attention. Somebody destroyed their gods. It is the big god. Let's go and ask him. So what do they say? فرجعوا لأنفسهم فقالوا إنكم أنتم الظالمون. They realized something was wrong. And they said among themselves, maybe it is us. Maybe it is us that something is wrong. ثم نكسوا على رؤوسهم لقد علمت ما هؤلاء ينطقون. And then people, إن الإنسان أكثر شيء جدلا. Argue is wrong. So they tell him, but you know they don't talk. سبحان الله. So they don't talk. A young man could destroy them all, and yet their logic says they're okay. So here, again, that dialogue, you know they do not talk. So he tells them, do you worship other than Allah? What does not do any benefit? And they cannot protect themselves. And that's the whole idea from the action of Ibrahim. He knows that his people will be very angry. He knows they're very upset, but he had to speak out. And when we see something wrong, من رأى منكم منكراً فليمنعه. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, when you see something wrong, stop it. First with your hand, if you're authorized to do it with your hand. If not, with your tongue, advise them, tell them it's wrong. If not, with your heart, and that's the weakest. Subhanallah. So when we see something wrong, we don't say it's not my own business, mind your own business, any harm. So we see Musa and Harun were afraid, and that they went. Ibrahim alayhi salam seen, and he wanted to help his people, and he started the dialogue. So what do they tell him? They say, burn him and support your gods. Subhanallah. So here, yes, they are tyrants and they want to punish him and burn him. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like he told Musa and Harun, inni ma'akuma asma'u wa ara, I am with you, I see and I hear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ibrahim. So when they tie him up and throw him in the fire, as we said before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have made it rain and there's no fire. Or could have done winds or air or, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left the fire burning and let them tie him up and throw him in the fire. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the order, قُلْنَا يَا نَارْ كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمٍ. Allah tells the fire, be cool and peaceful on Ibrahim alayhi salam. So no harm could come to him. And as we said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the order, قُلْنَا يَا نَارْ كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا, we said to the fire, be cool and peaceful. Every fire on earth stopped because the order, they didn't know the rest of the order. As soon as they heard the word in Kuni Bardu wa Salam, every fire on earth had stopped its quality of burning because this is the order. And then Ala Ibrahim, they realized it's only for Ibrahim to be peaceful and called on him, and the fires carried on their natural function. So here, Ibrahim alayhi salam talked, and Ibrahim alayhi salam, yes, the wrath came on him, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect him. وَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا فَجْعَلْنَاهُمُ الْأَخْسَرِينَ. They wanted to harm him, but they are the one who lost, because in front of everybody, he walked out peaceful and safe. But still, Allah only guides, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتُ وَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You do not guide whoever you please, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who guides. Did they see the miracle and they believed? Most of them, if not all of them, didn't believe, because this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the guidance. And it says, وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقُ وَيَعْقُوبُ. And as we know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, his wife could not bear any children. And when they came to tell her the news that she was going to have children, she said, عَجُوزٌ عَقِيمٌ. An old lady who's barren is going to have children. قَالُوا كَذَلِكَ قَالَ رَبُّ. That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided. So here, she didn't have children. He wanted to have children. As we know, he had Ismail from before, but Ismail and his mother, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has asked him to move them to Mecca, and he grew up with no children with him, and here he had the children. Ajmur and Aqim, old and barren, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But note, if we look at the ayah, وهبنا له إسحاق ويعقوب. We gave him إسحاق, which is his son. But not only the son, the grandchild too. يعقوب is a grandchild. So not only are they going to live long enough to have a child, but they're going to live long enough to see the grandchild too and enjoy the grandchildren. Why? Because they were patient and they accepted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ruling. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him. And yes, his wife couldn't have kids, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made have kids and they see their grandchildren too. This is the end of the story, is when we go through a trial and we see the prophets going through this hardship and we know إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And these stories in the Quran is not just for the prophets, it's for all of us to learn. When we rely on Allah and accept Allah's ruling, inshallah we will get everything we ask for. ونوحا إذ نادى من قبل فاستجبنا فنجيناه وأهله من الكرب العظيم. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us about Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. إذ نادى من قبل, when he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save him من القوم الظالمين, from the aggressors, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala فاستجبنا له. Always you see in the Quran, the letter fah means right away. He prayed and the fah comes right away. It could be summa, means it will happen after a while. But فاستجبنا, the letter fah in the Quran means his prayer will answer right away, and the answer came right away. فاستجبنا له فنجيناه وأهله من الكرب العظيم. And we saved him and his family. And yet in the Quran it tells us in Surah Hud, Allah, when he asked his son, come with us on board the ship because the world is drowning, the son said, no, dad, I will go on a high mountain and that will save me. So Nuh alayhi salam told him, the only savior is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would save. So the waves came between them. And if you read in Surah Hud, it describes that the wave came between them. Why? Because it didn't want Nuh alayhi salam to see his son drowning. So he didn't see what happened. This is the mercy of Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ إِنَّهُ عَمَلُ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ. He's not from your family. Why? Because he didn't believe in Allah. The family has to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, he did not believe in Allah because المؤمنون إخوة. The believers are brothers and sisters. The non-believers are not part of this. So he's not, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ. He's not your family. And he drowned because he did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فاستجبنا له. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Nuh, he seen his son drowning. He asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the savior, and Allah saves him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وداود وسليمان يحكمان في الحرس. Subhanallah, another lesson to learn. Dawood is a king, and there is a group of people who had some sheep, and their sheep got lost in a field, and they destroyed the field, destroyed all the plants, and the people that owned this field came to complain to Dawood, the king and the prophet, to ask, get us our right back. And if we look here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes both Dawood and Sulaiman, كُلًّا أَتَيْنَا حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا. We have given them hukm, the ruling and the knowledge. So Dawood has knowledge, and Sulaiman has knowledge. So what does Dawood rule? Take the sheep, the people, the field was destroyed, to take the sheep, and this way they can sell it, they can do what they like, and it pays for the destroyed crop. It seems fair, it seems just. The other group was negligent to leave their sheep go wild, and Dawood, with his judgment, is to give the sheep to the owners of the land. However, Prophet Sulaiman, which he has ilm too, he has knowledge, but he has more something different than knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَفَهَّمْنَاهَا سُلَيْمَان. Not only knowledge, but he has understanding. So we can all have knowledge, but we don't understand or we don't see it from the right angle, even though we have knowledge. And this is very important. Even though we have knowledge, we have to respect that some people might see it differently and some people might deal with the same knowledge differently. Why? Because he not only has knowledge, he has understanding, which is a higher level. It's the application of knowledge in life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this specific situation give this extra understanding to Sulaiman alayhi salam. So he went to his father and told the people stand, and not in front of the people. He went alone between him and his father and said, Father, this is not the right judgment. The right judgment would be that they take the sheep, the people that were land was destroyed, take it as borrow it, use the wool, use the milk and everything, and the other guys fix the land, and then once it's fixed, they return to each other. And this way, the guys who own the sheep, we don't destroy their livelihood, because that was their only source of livelihood for them. So he came that both are, he compensated the people that the land was destroyed, but still helped the people, the other people. And this is, in Islam, it's called the fadl. There is justice and there is fadl. Justice means what's right is right. Fadl is the other guy gives a little bit because maybe the guilty party needs some help. So this is fadl, where Sulaiman came up with the answer, and Dawood alayhi salam, his arrogance, no arrogance to say, no, I ruled, I'm not gonna go back. He realized there's a better solution, and he changed his. And that's a lesson for all of us. We should not be arrogant. When we hear something better, we go back and admit, maybe we were right, but there's still something better, and we change. These are the lessons we need to learn. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَيُّوبُ إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. Ayyub alayhi salam, masahu dur, harm has come to him. As we know, he became sick, that his friends and everybody, he was rich and he had a big family, he became very sick, he lost his money, his friends would stay away and everything, subhanallah. So he felt all alone. And when his wife would tell him, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure you, he tells her, I am embarrassed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made me healthy for 20 years. And I have not been unhealthy for 20. Wait till I'm unhealthy for 20, and then it's even, and then I can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure me. Because at least I was healthy for 20, I should not complain that I'm unhealthy till I reach 20 years. But he says, أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ. Harm have touched me, subhanAllah. He didn't say, Ya Allah, you caused this to me, or why did you cause this? He says, Ya Allah, harms have touched me, وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. And you are the most merciful. Again, it says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. Right away, as soon as he prayed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ فَكَشَفْنَا مَا بِهِ مِنْ دُرُّ. We have relieved the harm. وَأَتَيْنَاهُ أَهْلَهُ وَمِثْلُهُمْ مَعَهُمْ. And this is very important. Not only did he become better, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him family again, and more money again, double what he had, subhanAllah. And this is very important lesson. When we believe in Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, we all have to go through hardship. This is sunnah al-hayah. أَحَسَبَ النَّاسُ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا أَمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Does people think they can say we believe and they're not going to be tested? They will be tested. But if we are patient and we rely on Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us everything back and more, just like Ayyub. And this is the lessons we learn. We, as we're going through the list of the prophets and the hardship they had, we learn the lessons. And we know it applies for us too, inshallah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, all the children of Adam commit mistakes. The best of those who commit mistakes is those who ask for forgiveness. So let's pray to Allah and ask for His forgiveness. Alhamdulillah, wa shahadu an la ilaha illallah, wa shahadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And the next prophet is Zannun, Yunus alayhi salam. ذهب مغاضبا فظن ان نقدر عليه فنادى في الظلمات ان لا اله الا الله انت سبحانك اني كنت من الظالمين. He preached to his people and he showed them everything and they still don't want to believe. So he finally gives up. He says, maybe I should go and spend my time with somebody else, they will believe. I've tried, I've worked for years, and as we know, Nuh alayhi salam, 950 years giving da'wah and only a few believed. So he's decided, enough, I will move somewhere else. Maybe others will believe and my efforts will go. And how many of us, we keep trying in something and we say, I'm going to change. Maybe I give up and I want to change. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, no, I want you to keep with these people. So as we know, he goes on the ship and he drowns and he goes in the whales and he says, La ilaha illa anta subhanak inni kuntu min al-zalimin. He prays to Allah. and he acknowledged la ilaha illa. And in the toughest time, he didn't use his cellular or whatever to reach somebody that the phone is busy or he got voicemail. He calls Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always listening. فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. The answer comes right away. And this is for all of us. The first thought should be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rather than to our mobile phone, who's going to help us. The first we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, in the toughest time, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمْ. And he goes to the same people he found them all have believed. Subhanallah, it is إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتُ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You do not guide who you please, who you think. إِنَّكَ تَهْدِ مَنْ لَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. And as I gave you this example before, a friend of mine who was married to a non-Muslim, he tried to guide her. She wouldn't become a Muslim. His sheikh said, son, bring her to me. I will convince her. She doesn't become. His father says, I'm the one, son. Just bring her and she will believe. But no, she doesn't. And I asked him, did you ask Allah? He said, no. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتُ وَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Why don't we go to Allah? Everybody, each one of us, the arrogance think we can do it. And even though the ayah is clear, the guidance is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not from anybody else. Subhanallah. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided them. He worked all these years and he couldn't convince them. He left, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to teach him and all of us a lesson. Don't give up, and it is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Zakariya is nada rabbahu rabbi la tazirni fardan wa anta khayrul warisin. Zakariya did not have children, subhanallah, whether it's him or his wife, but he wants children. So what does he say? رَبِّ لَا تَذِنِّي فَرْضًا وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْوَارِثِينَ. Allah, don't leave me alone. I'd like حَبْلِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ ذُرِّيَّةً طَيِّبَةً. Give me good children, good ذُرِّيَّةً. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. We have answered his prayer. Subhanallah. When his heart went with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah answered. So here, each problems, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers and answers the prayers. So regardless of what our problem is, and regardless of what our issue is, we go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be confident that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer the prayer, inshallah. And that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِنَّ هَذِي أُمَّتْكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُونَ. This is your nation, the nation of the believers. Believers from the day of Adam عليه السلام. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The deen for Allah is Islam. What some people say, it is the Islam we know that was brought by the Prophet Muhammad. But إِنَّ الدِّينَ is a statement, a fixed statement that could not change. It is from the creation of Adam, the religion of Islam. Islam is the same from Adam till today, which is La ilaha illallah. What had changed is some of the Sharia. How they fast, nations different, how they fast, how they pray. But the religion, which is La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, La ilaha illallah, the religion itself has always been the same throughout time. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna ad-deena 'inda Allah al-Islam, it's the Islam that from Adam till today, which is to worship Allah and submit to the will of Allah. And that's all the stories. And if you find, you find even Pharaoh, أَنِّي أَعْمُلْ بِإِلَهِ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. When he's dying, he believes. Muslimin. Islam, Muslimin, is from the first day till today. You find all the prophets says, وَأَنَا مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. I am a Muslim. That's the Islam. What had changed is the Sharia, how we fast, how we pray. These are things that change throughout time. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the deen is one religion, which is Islam. And إِنَّ هَذِي أُمَّتْكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً. And this is one nation, which is the nation of believers. أَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُونَ. And we have one thing in common, which is we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَقَطَّعُوا أَمْرَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ كُلٌّ إِلَيْنَا رَاجِعُونَ. But even though it's one religion, and we are one nation, the nation of believers, but we separated ourselves. Each one gives himself a name, whether it's the Christians, the Jews, or. But even within us Muslims, how many people? You ask him, what's your religion? He says, I'm a Sunni, or Shia, or. No, we're all Muslims. there is no such a thing. As I mentioned before, a brother in Saudi Arabia says, Alhamdulillah, he's become a Sunni. I told him he's become a Muslim. There is no such a thing as Sunni or Shia. These are words that was created to divide us. Because when I ask who are you and what I am and what's, divide ourselves. We are all Muslims. And we all hold on to the deen of Allah, the Hablullah, the religion of Allah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. So yes, they've divided themselves into sects, and we have divided ourselves, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the final answer. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنْ فَلَا كُفْرَانَ لِسَعِيهِ. He who does good deeds, and he believes. He believes in Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reward. That is the final thing, is we have to do good deeds, and we have to believe in Allah, that la ilaha illallah, and we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all and guide everybody else, rather than try to say they are different, what they do is different. We are one nation, it is the nation of believers, and we should not divide ourselves or separate ourselves. And regardless of what trouble each one of us goes through, go and look at this Surah Al-Anbiya, and you see one of the prophets had gone through, and you see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save us too. All we have to do is believe, do istighfar, and taqwa Allah, and inshaAllah, Allah will relieve whatever curb or whatever problem we go through.